Alright, we are now into week 9, chapter 14, Oscillators, Phase Lock Loop, and Tone Decoder. For this particular chapter, which is 12 pages long, I'm going to break it into 4 parts. So, 3 pages for each part, so each video does not end up being too bad or too long. Now, before we get started, let's get some background. An oscillator requires 3 critical things to operate. The first being amplification. Because of losses, there has to be some way to amplify the signal. If there's no amplification, you might start off with a good oscillation, but it'll tamp down as we get through it. Positive feedback. This really kind of goes with number 1. You have to have a way of reinforcing the signal. Otherwise, the oscillation just, you know, dies out. Kind of like when you hit a bell. The bell rings, it vibrates, but over time, as the energy from the impact with the bell dies off and turns to sound and heat and everything, the ringing will die off. So we need some positive feedback to keep it going. And the third thing might seem a little weird, but it has to have some means to start. I know this sounds a little strange, but for example, you have a process. Many of the processes, you have like a high voltage here and a low voltage over here, and it's doing this. But if for some reason they're both low, there's no high to transfer to the low. So in a lot of the processes, you're going to see this teeter-totter effect. And if you can't start it, well, it's just not going to oscillate. A little side story. I had many years back, had a friend who had built a 1-cylinder steam engine. Now, this was a model train. You could ride on it even. Wonderful, wonderful engine. But it was only 1-cylinder. And he learned something very important about it. Thankfully, it was a model steam engine, so it was no big deal for him to kind of push it forward. But he discovered if the piston was in the wrong position, like it's fully extended out, adding steam will not make it go anymore. Now, if it were in and in the forward stroke, it would actually work. If it's in the opposition, you can't start it. So this kind of goes with point 3. There has to be a means to start it. In his case, he would just manually put his foot down and kind of shuffle his feet to get the engine going. Can't do that in the full-size engines, though. So anyway, oddly enough, having told you an oscillator needs positive feedback, there are some that require negative feedback in the gain. And you're going, what? Which is it, positive or negative? Well, sometimes it can be both. Now, in this case, we want an undistorted sine wave. And too much gain would cause the top and bottom half of the sine wave to flatten out. So in that case, if the amplitude of the sine wave gets too big, we have negative feedback to lower the gain. Okay, now another issue is to remember a constant voltage through a resistor to a capacitor results in a non-linear exponential voltage curve. Actually, inverse exponential, but I'm getting picky here. If we feed a constant current, and this is the thing, to a capacitor, you will get a linear voltage rise. And a constant current discharge would give us a linear voltage fall. Now, I'm going to bring up the graph. This guy. Okay, very, very important that you be able to look at these waveforms. And yes, I know in the picture, it over here, it says sine wave, square wave, triangle, sawtooth. You must be able to see a waveform and without seeing the name here, be able to name it. Now, the sine wave is the beautiful smooth curve. Square waves, sharp rise and fall. triangle is actually related to the sawtooth. The difference here is it's a linear rise and an equally same linear fall. The rate of rise matches the rate of fall. The sawtooth is really a triangle with non-matching rise and fall. In this case, it rises quickly. You can't go from 100% to 0% instantly. So there is a little bit of fall time. It just doesn't show in the drawing. And the sawtooth gets its name because if you look at a saw blade, it kind of tends to look like that. So these are kind of what I call the top four waveforms. Whether we're testing amplifiers or other devices, sine wave is very useful. It allows us to see for that given frequency, did it work? Square wave is interesting because it has all the odd harmonics. Triangle shows the linearity of an amplifier, and of course the sawtooth even works nicely because if this were to, the input were straight up or straight shot like this and it were to bow upward or bow downward, your amplifier isn't very linear. Although it would show here on the triangle too, it's just a little bit bigger. Now, some things about the, I mentioned how the change in the charge and discharge rates is really the difference between triangle and sawtooth. Now, of all those waveforms you saw, only the sine wave is a pure fundamental frequency. So if I put up a 1 kHz sine wave and you put it on a spectrum analyzer, it's a 1 kHz tone. Nothing else is there. It would appear as a thin line on a spectrum analyzer. All the other waves have harmonics. Now, harmonics are waves of higher frequency added to the fundamental frequency. Let's go back to this. 1 kHz. Put it on a sine wave on a spectrum analyzer, just a single line at 1 kHz. Square wave, 1 kHz. You're going to see the line at 1 kHz, and you're going to see at 3 kHz a line about 1/3 the size of the fundamental frequency. Then at 5 kHz, a line that's 1/5 the size of the fundamental frequency, and so on. The higher up you go, the cleaner the rise and the less ripple there is here. Okay, so I apologize. Off the top of my head, I can't remember the harmonics of the sawtooth and the triangle. These are all odd harmonics. I believe these guys have some even harmonics, but off the top, I can't remember. Okay, first oscillator. And strangely enough, this is one that I remember from high school electronics, and it's kind of a fun circuit. You have a power supply here, and usually the voltage has to be 90 volts. You might get away with less, but 90 volts is ideal. 120 will also work. We have a fairly large resistor here that limits the current. We have a capacitor. The voltage will cause the capacitor to pick up a charge. When we first power it up, it starts at 0 volts, and it will climb according to the RC time constant. As this climbs in voltage, it will reach a threshold where the neon inside the lamp at lower voltages does not conduct. No current is going through it. You will finally hit the trip point, and let me just roll this up just to hear, where it will begin to conduct. And so usually about 60 volts, but it varies a bit with neon lamps. It'll begin conducting the current, which causes the capacitor to discharge. Now this is not, the resistor is not supplying enough current to keep the neon lamp going constantly. So the amount of current going through the neon lamp is greater, far greater than what the resistor can supply. So this will drop down to probably about 40 volts. It's a fairly quick drop, and the light will flash. And then, of course, once it hits 40 volts, the neon here acts like an insulator, so the capacitor will go from 40 volts to 60 volts. And then again, the cycle repeats on and on and on. Now, with 90 volts, we keep the resistor within the 1 megohm to 5 megohm range, and the capacitor You don't want to go too big because you really might damage the bulb. 1 microfarad to 5 microfarad, just enough to get a flash out of it. And it was kind of a cute circuit. There are variations of the circuit. I remember back in the 60s, a very popular circuit used 2 neon bulbs and had some capacitors to have them alternate back and forth. They were sort of interconnected together. It wasn't 2 separate oscillators. And it was quite common to get a teddy bear with 2 neon eyes and you turn on the battery and the eyes blink. Didn't take much to entertain kids back then. Anyway, so that pretty much describes our first oscillator. This is known as a relaxation oscillator. It sort of kind of produces a sawtooth. It's not really a sawtooth. It looks like a distorted sawtooth compared to here, but that's the name. Okay, now part of the problem is it's not a good sawtooth because it's being fed by a constant voltage source. What it really needs is a constant current source. Now, if it were a constant current, then it would start to look like a true sawtooth. Now, I'll tell you a story about many years ago, a long time ago, 1970s. What I did is I knew this problem, and so I needed a sawtooth waveform. So I ended up using a very high voltage and really increased the resistance. In fact, I used a 3000 volt power supply through a 30 mega ohm series resistor. Okay, what happened was, as the difference between 3000 minus 40 volts versus 3000 minus 60 volts, the difference in current was so slight, it really made this very linear, or almost linear. I don't recommend anybody do it. You know, it was back when I was going through the program and doing stupid stuff. But today, of course, we would use a unijunction transistor. So here is a relaxation oscillator with a unijunction transistor. And you can kind of see how they're drawing it like it's a sawtooth, but actually it's going to have that bow in it. And of course, I'll explain in a second. When it conducts, we get a downward spike here and an upward spike here. So here's such a circuit. In this particular case, it says it's really, I know they use a comma in Europe where we use a decimal point, but this is 6.8 nanofarads. Rarely do we see that in the US. So that's 6,800 picofarads, or 0.0068 microfarads. But anyway, so we have a 9-volt battery, 100 k-ohm, which is adjustable. And so this could go from 0k to 100k, 4.7 k-ohm. Again, they use commas in Europe frequently, where we use a period. And that'll slowly charge up this capacitor. And when it hits a certain critical voltage, suddenly the transistor, just like the neon bulb, will conduct. And when it conducts from emitter to base 1, current will flow from base 2 to base 1. So this will really conduct a lot of current until this capacitor finally discharges to a point where conduction can no longer occur. This shuts it off, which stops the current flow between B2 and B1. So this would create a nice little chirp or something on the speaker. Now, another astable multivibrator uses an op amp. And you'll notice I didn't label the components here, but these resistors, I would keep them like 10K, 10K would be a good example, but it would work if it were 100K, 100K. It's not that, as long as they're the same value. So let's assume that this is plus 12, minus 12. Whatever voltage is here, half that voltage appears on the plus input. Now, if 12 volts is coming out here, eventually it'll go through the resistor, charge up the capacitor. So if it's plus 12, this will reach a point where it crosses the threshold of 6 volts here, and then it'll flip the output low. Now that the output's low, I'll explain that in a second. And by the way, an interesting variation would be a 10K here, 10K here, and where you have right here in the schematic, put a 10K pot so that this kind of wipes between the upper and lower end. In fact, you can make this 1K, 1K, and put a 20K ohm pot here and just slide back and forth. That would vary the point or the threshold that the trip occurs. So you can make it really tiny, which would increase the frequency, or very large, which would lower the frequency. So there's some fun things you could, this is a really simple circuit, but a lot of fun you could have with this. Now, assuming this is 10K and 10K, now we look at these two, the capacitor on top and the resistor. A good approximation, and I stress the word is approximated here, would be take the value of the capacitor in microfarads times the value of the resistor, probably in K ohms. Take this constant value, 0.456, divided by these two multiplied together, and you will get the frequency. So let's assume we have a 1 microfarad and a 10K ohm resistor. 0.456 divided by these two multiplied together gives us 45.6 hertz. So depending upon how we want to do that, you know, you could adjust it. And the power supply here I mentioned in the text, it could be plus 15, minus 15, but it didn't matter. It could be plus 12, minus 12, plus 9, minus 9. It'll work the same no matter what. If you made it plus 12 minus 9, it'll be a little lopsided in its operation. Now, this particular picture here on page 3 really kind of shows us what's happening. If we look at the capacitor here, and it's really a shame they overlaid three waveforms. The original photo was in color, and so when you reprint it in black and white, it just doesn't work. The capacitor is charging up until it reaches the plus 0.6 threshold. The output is plus 12 volts. When it crosses the threshold, the minus is greater than the plus. Let's go back to this image. See, so when this guy is greater than 6 volts, this is going to switch to a minus. And so it does. Boom. Well, now the threshold point changes from plus 6 to minus 6. Okay, so down we are here, and we're going to be, it's going to start because this is minus 12 volts. This will be minus 6 volts. Because it's a negative and this is a positive, it's going to start discharging. And eventually it'll drop below minus 6 volts. And when it does that, bingo! There's the threshold. The plus is greater than the minus. So it's going to go plus 12 output. Half of that is plus 6. It's going to start to charge up again. As you can see, it's just a repeating pattern. Every time the capacitor reaches a certain point, it'll flip over. Okay. Now, the voltage divider, I just use assume plus 6 and minus 6. You know, assuming that the output is plus 12, minus 12. Okay, but it doesn't really matter. And this text just goes on and on and on explaining it. Now, I told you earlier, what if this was 1K and 1K, and I put a 20K ohm pot here, and we had a little slider that went back and forth. Well, by sliding it this way, the threshold that has to be reached is very low, and therefore it switches faster. By sliding it this way, it's got to go way up there or way down there to reach the threshold. It takes longer, the frequency is lower. So that's what I wanted to point out. Okay, you can read the text. All right, last thing for this segment, the Pierce oscillator. Okay, now, most Pierce oscillators will use a CMOS inverter rather than an op-amp for the circuit. Could be done with an op-amp, but it's almost always this little CMOS inverter. I know U1 doesn't say CMOS, but that is definitely the symbol for an inverter. Pierce oscillators are found in many of the clock circuits, especially microprocessors, and really it's where you need very stable and accurate timing. And the idea behind it is, let's look at what an inverter does. If I put a 1 here, I get a 0 here. If I put a 0 here, I get a 1 here. So this is constantly the opposite. Okay, so I'm going to have 0 volts here. It's going to be a 1 here. This charges up, and eventually the voltage kind of bleeds across, begins to charge up this capacitor, and suddenly this starts looking less like a 0 and more like a 1. Well, when this is a 1, that's going to become a 0, and it's going to discharge this guy completely. Okay, but it's going to bleed across and eventually switch it over again. So this guy is acting like a teeter-totter. The energy is going back and forth between these two capacitors. If you could see it on a scope, you know, put a probe here and here, you'd see these two are 180 degrees out of phase, which takes into account this is 180 degrees out of phase anyway. So this, by the way, the Pierce oscillator, when you walk away from this lecture, just remember, it's extremely accurate. So here's my wristwatch. Now, this wristwatch, deep inside, has a Pierce oscillator. There is a 32768 hertz crystal. That's what they typically use for wristwatches, electronic wristwatches. And it's a Pierce oscillator that's been trimmed to be extremely accurate. And so, very, very accurate timing, you know, anywhere from 1 to 10 parts per million error. So very, very, very nice device. And so for wristwatches, we want accuracy, because there's nothing worse than a wristwatch that loses or gains a minute every day. So you need this just where it's only a fraction of a second shift after maybe a week or so. Although I have to tell you, okay, sorry, side note. This is one of the Casio radio watches. You probably didn't know that the National Bureau of Standards, WWV, Fort Collins, Colorado, on 60 kilohertz transmits the time signal every minute. The wristwatch late at night will tune in to that broadcast, and if it's a little off, it'll reset itself to the correct time. In fact, I love it when we have the time change, you know, daylight savings or whatever. Because National Bureau of Standards basically tells the watch, yes, time to change to the new time zone. Anyway, side thought. Okay, so that covers the first three pages. Next time, we'll get into page 4. We're going to look at the different oscillators. You may want to read it ahead. And with that, I'll say have a good night or day, whichever works out. And take care.